Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we continue with the tutorial how to fine-tune an LLM for document classification with your own dataset. I will do a little bit of recap of what we did up to now, as it's gonna be a little bit a change of approach. So if you remember in the first part of the tutorial, I create a classifier with a flantified LLM, and we use a dataset I got from Kaggle that with 10 classes, 100 document per class. Well, that was working pretty well. Also, if you remember, the objective of my project is create a classifier with 49 classes according to the Microsoft PureView classification or categories that they already create. We have here the description. I already push all this stuff in the previous tutorials of this series. Well, in the second video, I commented that we will do in a web scraping, collecting 500 documents using the DataGo API, and we're collecting using the engine of DataGo to find documents related to one of these categories. And we were successfully doing, and we found documents in the cloud, in internet, regarding these categories with something related to this content. Then on before record this tutorial, I just simply try to download all these documents, and what happened was simply that Google, DataGo, or any engine is simply forbidden or making this very difficult, no? And then not only the Google or DataGo or other search engine, it's just there is a lot of restriction, and many webs are also protected with DDoS protection, and well, I decide finally that this is gonna be very difficult, a very time-consuming trying to collect documents from internet, and then on parsing them, and well, create a pipeline in this way. So what I decided, well, I changed. I was thinking how to approach this in a different way, because it's gonna be difficult to get documents and to get data to train the model in the same way I did it in the POC. And then, well, I just figure out how to do this slightly different. And then I came to the conclusion that well, maybe we can use an LLM and just asking, well, you have this test, and classify this text according to these classes, so simply using prompt instruction, which is, well, is something that definitely an LLM can do. Why not to try this approach? We don't lose anything. Well, and then thinking how to solve the problem, I got the conclusion that, well, we are in an environment, or at least in the environment I'm working on. Well, I just connect to a data lake. I'm going to connect to a data lake or to a folder, to somewhere else. I'm going to, or in the project I'm for what I'm going to create this model, we just received a bunch of data. We don't know which format. We just know that there is some files that are in a data lake with And then we just need to classify them according to these categories, these 59 categories. That's it. And then, well, what to do in that case? No. And then I thought, well, what not to use another technology that first of all allow me to read any kind of content without changing or needing to use different libraries to open PDFs, docs, PPTs, TXT, whatever you have in a data lake, because as you may know, in a data lake you can find whatever, no? it's not that you are gonna find just PDFs or docs correctly formatted and so on and so forth. Well, and then I was doing or rethinking how to approach the problem, and then on LangChain the library came to my mind to solve the or to give me an idea of how to solve this problem. And then I redefined the problem, and this is what I'm going to explain you here, how I'm thinking, how I'm going to solve this issue. Then my approach right now is gonna be use LangChain as a framework to read what I have or what I'm going to receive from the data lake, parse these documents, take every document. I don't know the size they have. It's gonna be arbitrary. Can be 10,000 words, 100,000 words, 1,000,000 words, nobody knows. And then what I pretend to do with this is just take the documents, make a summary of the documents, and then on send this or produce with the summary a vector, which later on I will compare with the vectors produced with the information of the 59 categories I have. I don't know if at the end I just will choose the most likely category, which using cosine similarity or something similar, comparing the resume of the document with the 59 classes, and then just tell, well, this document is just agreements or bank statements or finance audit, or gives you the most five likely categories or five tags with probabilities. We'll see. But for the moment, this is not relevant at this stage. What I'm thinking is, okay, take an NLM, make a document summary, and create a vector with a size that later on we can compare with the vectors that we create for each category that we had in our project, not in our data set. Okay, and then I make some tests with the LangChain. I was testing LangChain is a framework. Probably you know about that. You worked before with the LangChain. To be honest, it's a wonderful library that it allows you to do, well, practically all the steps related to what you need in terms of the how to prepare, how to handle, clean any document, any text that you need to send to an LLM for inference, and then on even to parsing out the information that the LLM produce to show to the user. And then in that case, well, there is a number of the classes and methods that you can use with LangChain that are very useful at least for the project I'm working on right now. And then it will allow me to read in this case PDFs, Excel, PowerPoints, Docs, whatever I have on the data lake, then on create pieces or chunks of this document. From these pieces, create the most relevant pieces that represent the documents, and then I'll make a summary from the document that I can use to create an embedding that later on I can compare with one of the 59 classes I had in my classification problem. Why I'm doing this way? Well, as you may know, and then I give you some reference here. Every LLM have a size or has a limitation on the number of tokens that you can send as input. No, I put some reference here. How GPT-4 or the OpenAI models are doing, how Mistral in this case is doing. You can have a size, a window size for input of 4096 together with the prompt 2192. So every model has a maximum number of the input tokens that you can use to create the prompt or the input prompt, and then on after that either the model fails or the model just ignore the tokens after the maximum that allowed. And then in order to do this, well, it's obvious that you will need to find out a mechanism or a logic to somehow avoid this problem, because imagine that as you will see in the project, in this tutorial, that you had a document with hundreds, thousands, or even millions of tokens. What you are gonna do with that? Just to take the first 8,192 tokens? No, you will not do that. You wish the approach here is just partition or make chunks of the documents and make resumes or summaries of every chunk, and then on aggregate the summaries in a single summary in a kind of aggregation. I did something here, probably it can be refined for other purposes, but it's the way that I plan to do it in my case. Just I wanted to show you here and just remark that every model, even ChatGPT, with ChatGPT is easy because we can use tick token. Every model, GPT-4 for example, had as well 8,192 tokens as input. Every model had his maximum input, and you will have to work out and figure out how you are gonna do this for the to tailor or to adapt the input to the model that you are working on. For GPT OpenAI model you had the token, for Hugging Face in general you had the Sentence Transformer library that you can use it for a general purpose or for any model that is available in Hugging Face. And at the end you will need to count and you take control of how many tokens you are going to set as input. It's not you make you may have some issues at the end of how you summarize or you work with the activity that you are working on. Okay. What I did here, again, I just create a logic where I'm going to take a document, split it in chunks, make a summary of these chunks, and then on aggregate the chunks and finally do a resume of these chunks. First of all, I make some tries with LangChain. Is if you don't know LangChain, LangChain is again a framework which has multiple. If you know, it's essentially a pipeline, no? Where you can first of all ingest data, transform the data, clean the data, etc., etc., and then on send this data. Either in a batch, in a chunk, chunk by chunk, to the model, and even you can format the output that launches. In few words, it's a pipeline technology to work with LLMs. Which LLMs you can work with? Any. In few words, any. Some of them have native integration with LangChain, like OpenAI or others, and some others just simply through a generic pipeline class that LangChain had with Hugging Face. You will see now in the tutorial how I'm working with two different models which are not natively integrated in LangChain, like DeFi from Google or Mistral 7 billion truth model, which are not integrated natively in LangChain, but you can work with them through a generic class. Okay, let's move. And then what I'm doing here, I'm working again in a Colab Pro with a P100, a GPU with 40 gigabytes of memory. I install the libraries I need. Also, I'm installing Spacy, LangChain, dataset, this we you saw before, transformer stores, well, etc. This is libraries we need just to make this work, LLMs and all the prompt engineering and all the stuff we are doing here. Once it's done, let me once go. Let's this finish. Just to let's load the model, and then we will look at the results. Probably with a T4 it will be enough, but well, we will stick be working with the V100. As well, case that the model is demanding more resources than AT4 can supply. Well, here the first I'm doing here is just showing you how you can count tokens, no? And then I'm just simply using a class, the sentence transform token text splitter, which by default is using a model for Hugging Face, all NP net base version 2, which is a model which has split the tests in tokens, no? And then this way you can just simply count the number of tokens that arbitrary text have inside, and this way you can decide how create logic how to split the text and then on send it in chunk to the LLM. I mount the drive and here I just take a test with this sorry for that sometimes. Okay, continue. Well, you know this So we mount the drive, we read a file I had in my drive, it's just an arbitrary text. Let me check, it's just... just txt, oh, where I am, oh, sorry. Okay, it's just a file. It doesn't really matter. It's not the purpose. It's just I also say here. Well, What I want to do with this, the splitter object, which is using this model for Hugging Face, is just giving us the number of tokens we had. Which tokenizer you can use? Well, whatever is available in Hugging Face, done simple than that. You can use Spacey, you can use these models, everything that is in Transformer that follow the Sentence Transformer API is possible to be used for you in there to count tokens for a model. It's different, there is a different depending on what model, yes, but to be honest, at the end of the day, if you get a number of tokens, which is, for example, here we got 189. For this problem, to solve this problem, and then at the end we are going to break the documents in a number of tokens, you just can make an assumption or take a pragmatic approach and then never go close to the limit of what a model is imputing. No? So if in ChatGPT you had 8,192 tokens as input together with the prompt, well, let's divide the text in chunks of 4,000 tokens, and then this way, well, it's probably a little bit more work, no? It's more processing time, but you don't need to create a complicated logic to handle when you are out or not out, and then always to the limit, no? Obviously, it's more efficient to do it that way, but again, be pragmatic and then just create a simple logic that split the document in something that realistically can work with most of the models. You don't need to worry about what is the site that affects, for example, a Mistral, a Falcon, a T5, whatever models you are going to use, but most of them are about, especially the newest model, about 4,096 tokens. So, well, let's do something that is a little bit below that. And keep in mind that you need to include the prompt, no, the instructions that you are going to send to the model. This way, yeah, again, you can create a very complicated logic for that, but probably it's not worth it when it's better to do just, okay, just take 1,500 tokens, create a prompt, send it to the LLM, make a summary, and move to the next step, okay? So here, I load the Sol libraries, I load the Mistral, and just gonna do a test here and show you how you can use Mistral with LangChain. It's gonna take a while to it loads all the files, so I will make a pause and then on I will continue when it's downloaded. Okay, this already finished. It takes 10 minutes just to it download all the files. Again, probably you hear me many times speak about this. Keep in mind the size of the model. No, this model is only 15 gigabytes of memory of files. It can run perfectly in a domestic GPU, a little bit bigger than a domestic GPU, but well, you can work with that in a Colab Pro, which is something that everybody can have or can be can have access to that. So I'm loading the model in 4 bits, which is very we are not using too much memory. But again, this model is 7 billion, just considering or comparing with other models that you may know, like Falcon or GPT 3.5 Turbo, which is 700 billion. This model is 100 times smaller than GPT 3.5 Turbo. If we compare with GPT 4, I have no even reference. Maybe we can do a calculation. The GPT-4 is 1.13 trillions of parameters, but you cannot run GPT-4 in a Colab Pro notebook, no? So I think that we discussed in previous videos what is the importance of the choosing correctly the model. This is one of the examples. You can use a very good model with very good performance, with very well trained for many activities. Now we are going to use it for document summarization, for two activities you will see now with LangChain, and then you can run it in a domestic GPU. Later you can even prepare a Docker and do some inference, and it's performing really well. You don't need to pay for OpenAI for their models, and for even that is inexpensive, you can do it with some other alternatives. Here what we are gonna do, first of all we create a prompt. It's very simple prompt. I took these examples from LangChain repository. They had multiple very good documentation on how to use it. Again, very good technology. You need to know how it works if you want to work in this space, because it's one of the references. You have other alternatives like Llama Index, but we will take a look to this in future tutorials, but for now let's focus on LangChain, which today is one of the state-of-the-art libraries in this matter, no? We create the prompt, and also we create the prompt. You can see here you are telling the model that Atta's a gourmet, you had a friend which is vegetarian, you want to impress him, you want to create you're going to prepare some food for a vegetarian guy or person, and then you ask for two options and also to get the receipt and the details how to do it, and the outcomes are really impressive. And again, this is a model which is public. You don't need to pay for that, and you can use it in your pipelines, in your workflows, in your company, whatever, and it's essentially working. And again, if you remember all the tutorials I was preparing before, OpenAI has a training cost of $64 million. You can get this for free. So, it's up to you what you want to use. But I would rather use something like this and personalize a Mistral or something like a T5 model with that free to use to an activity, regardless of the catastrophic forget problem. I would rather personalize these models for my purpose better than use OpenAI GPT-4 or GPT-3.5 Turbo for that purpose. They are gonna go fine, and it's up to you. Look at the answer. It's giving you vegan chickpea curry, and the second is spaghetti with mushrooms and asparagus. So I don't know, I'm cooking at home, so I know how to prepare this, but I never prepare, I'm not vegetarian, if somebody can verify it is correct, I'm glad to hear some comments on the chat, no? I send another prompt to the same model. No specialization, it's just taking the model from Hugging Face as it was trained. If you remember, Mistral was trained with a multiple model for multiple data sets, for multiple purposes. I just here asking the model that explain me what is a digital currency, a cryptocurrency, and you have to ask explain me this assuming that I'm a child of IR. This is incredible. Imagine that you had a different use case, that you are in a company, you had to explain for different audiences, different personas, how something, a process, the onboarding process, the human resources, the engineering, how to ask, and then there is different roles, different personas, different audiences in your companies. And then listen again, you can use a model and pay for that, but you can do it this for free. It's just a matter of your engineering team to make something that it can work. And look the answer of the model to this question, no? So, and this is just how to say native answer. We didn't personalize the model for a purpose. Even if you personalize with some information, this model is gonna give you even more tailored answers to the problem that you are asking for. So, and then again, implicit answers, and here the purpose is not use how Mistral is working, that all of us know that is a very good model. The purpose is see how the model is going to be working on with LangChain, no? And then how we do that? Well, very simple. We just simply use the pipeline object from Hugging Face. This pipeline object had a model, a tokenizer, this you know, tags. Tags, there is different tags. I will push later on the number of tags that are available in the pipeline, in the transformer pipeline. And the rest is just parameters that you send to the model, like temperature, repetition penalty. You probably remember from previous tutorials, this is if you find, if you are going, every model is generating words, and then on the next word is just analyze or produces looking at the parameters that you set up for the model. If you have a parameter that is stating something like that, the model is going to check if this word was generated before, and if it was generated before, it's going to do a penalty for that specific word, and in case that is not above a threshold, it's not going to produce it, or yeah, it's not going to be produced for the next word in the text generation of that model, no? Well, maximum of tokens in that case 1,000. We can set that this again up to maximum. We are using Mistral 8,192. And then on the second stage, just if we want to use LangChain, we just create an object having a face pipeline, and we pass the pipeline that we created before. Tan simple as that. How later on we send a prompt to the LangChain object? Well, we just create two some variables that need to be enclosed in curly brackets, like here, audience persona and question is in curly brackets. And then on just we create the templates. Now we make this reference to the variables. For example, audience persona is here, referencing to audience persona. Question here is referring to the question, and well, you will say, you are a expert in language science model. I will ask you a question for a given audience, and you will have to respond an answer easily understandable for this audience. So it's done simple than that. This is quite open. The only thing that you need to have to see to follow and to be compliant is with the way that you set up the inputs, no? You will see here in the prompt template that you have some input variables, and these input variables need to match with the variables that you want to introduce here. You will see here in the example that later on LangChain would use what you set up here in the input text object, and it will replace these variables with the input text that you write in your dictionary. Pretty simple, pretty straightforward. We create the prompt template, we create the chain. Again, the chain is not more than a pipeline. We create the chains with the Mistral LLM. That was the pipeline that we created before with the Mistral 7 billion object. For the task generation, again, this is multiple task different tasks. There is the task generation, there is summarization, there is translation, everything available. I will put you a link with everything that is available in the transformer pipeline. The prompt that you define here, the prompt template, and verbose true, this is going to show you all the steps that the Lang chain is taking to produce an answer. Now we create the input, audience persona is a fragile, but you can put here an engineer, a lawyer, a person who has no clue about what you are talking about, etc., etc. And the question that you are going to request to the model to be answered. You make the chain, you create the, with this object, you just ask the model to give you an answer. And as we create here verbose, you will see here that you have all the logs that the model is producing. Well, that is very quickly. We had the response, language models, blah blah blah. Well, you can take a look. You can play around with this. It's pretty simple, very straightforward. You receive a response object. The response object has the input and the output. No? Now we are going to explain you what I pretend to do. Is I use Lang chains, but instead to do the text generation, I will do summarization. And then for that matter, I use, as we say before, I'm using a T5. In that case, I'm going to use a T5 large instead to use a T5 base. But well, it's the same model training with the same dataset. The only thing that is containing more attention layers. In this case, this model has 750 million parameters, still, again, being a small model in comparison with other ones, even with Mistral, the 750 million parameters is nothing in LLMs. It's very small model, but very well trained and very, very well done model. No, we create the pipeline. In this case, we do summarization. We keep the parameters. It doesn't really matter. This, this just you need to adapt it, but we simply can remove it. It's not gonna be big difference. No. Okay, we create as well the Hugging Face pipeline. With the pipeline, we send the prompt, and here we are just sending, give me a summary of this document. As you can see here, there is some Greek. You remember T5 is trained to with more than 67 different languages. If I don't remember wrong, so you can send many, so you can send text in different languages, the model is going to understand. So you just send the prompt, and you just make the prompt to make a summary. Here we are just counting the tokens. We have 121 tokens using T5, and then just we ask the LLM to answer. Okay. Great. Philosophies, the system, the studio, blah blah blah. Well, you can play around with this. Use another text and see how it works. It's pretty straightforward working with LangChain. Secondly, I'm going to use some other libraries that I want to show you. One is this recursive character text splitter and PDF loader. So what I'm going to do here in the next example, I'm going to take a book, a whole book, is this book essentially, and I didn't read it, sorry, probably you did it. It's apparently a history of a guy who was in an expedition to Everest and everybody died except the guy who obviously wrote the book. But it's not funny, but well, it's what I just found this document. is a book. Is for the purpose of the experiment, it's just a book. You can why I tell you this background, because later the purpose is to make a summary. Later on, we will read the summary, which is just a couple of sentences, and it's explaining you what the model understood from the whole book. We use PDF loaders, not only so the LangChain is not only reading PDFs, it's reading a number. It has native loaders of many documents, PDFs, Office, a file directory, whatever you had is probably able to be read with the documents loaders already present in LangChain. So it's quite, how to say, convenient library, because it's with the same framework you can access the documentation. Here a PDF. If you have some experience in NLP, you may understand that reading, for example, PDFs, doc documents, Excel, is a nightmare. every document you need to use a different library, is you need to parse them, you need to clean it. If you have something that allow you to read multiple kind of documents, HTML, TXT, whatever, this is something that is going to facilitate your life a lot, no? That's I wanted to point you out this, because LangChain comes with all these document loaders. You have the documentation, so well you just need to go to LangChain and see what is able to do. Really impressive. Again, not only PDFs, again markdowns, CSVs, HTML, JSON, whatever, even docs, PowerPoints, whatever you have is practically able to read everything. And then on the good thing is they take the file, extract the text, and do the job for you. Just imagine that you need to read this PDF. You need to load a library, make the parsing yourself, create some methods. Probably it's a couple of hours just after you create. You also differentiate if the file contain data or metadata, and also contain images, and the images contain data. Then on you have to load a tesseract or whatever, another OCR library to just extract data from the document. This is doing everything for you in a single go. It's up to you to use it. Okay, now we count the number of tokens. Once we have, again, something that is very simple with LangChain is just, okay, we create an LLM. I create it with T5, and then I just simply send, okay, give me the number of tokens that you had in this test using this model. And then you see here 139,734, and then here is the first challenge, no? Okay, we had a document which is obviously far away of the bigger than the input that my model is going to use, even if you are going to use GPT-4 or other models from OpenAI. What I can do? Well, the answer is very simple. Split it in chunks that the model can accept as input. But I can do a very simplistic approach and say, well, I take the first 8,192 tokens, and I just ask him to the model to give me a summary or give me a class to what they belong. Well, but this is not very good approach, no? Because imagine that if this is a book, no? In the book, you just simply make a thank you to your family, to your friends, and to your producer, and you are not speaking anything about what is the content of the book. It's just the index and the thanks to everybody, and then you don't know what is the book talking about. So We need to find another approach. We need to read the whole context in chunks, obviously. Chunks that are going to be less or at least the size of the max input that the model is going to set, and then on trying to find how to summarize this in a simple text, no? And this is what I'm doing here, no? Let me show you what I did or what I'm proposing to do. I load some other libraries here. I use the recursive character text splitter. This is, you will see, is how to iterate through a model, you will see here, and create chunks of a specified size with an overlap. I will go here after that, no? We use a vector database. For what I'm using this, because I'm transforming every chunk I produce for the text in a vector. You can use different vectors models. I think I also put you a link to this. There is many. You can use Neo4j, you can use Hugging Face, you can use OpenAI, you can use Llama, you can use Elastic, you can use whatever, Spacy, whatever is available. There is a lot of ways to create an embedding, which at the end is a representation of that chunk or that text in a vector of a size. In this case, I'm using Hugging Face, and I'm creating vector of 768 dimensions. Okay. I load some other methods from or functions from LangChain. I will speak about that later on. And I also again use Hugging Face embeddings, and just simply, as I said before, using the sentence transforming this model to create embeddings. Okay. Then the text splitter. What is doing the text splitter? It's just taking the document. In this case, I'm saying, okay, take the document, take 10,000 characters, and do an overlap of 3,000. Why to do an overlap? Well, what we are saying here is just split the document and keep a relation with the chunk before and with the chunk you have afterwards. Why to do that? Because if we just split the text in different chunks without relation with the previous and the posterior, well, it may have the model may lose the context, no? And then you will see afterwards why I'm doing that, no? I'm just keeping an overlap. You can decide to have this overlap a little bit less, but I'm just creating chunks of the text. I divide the text in different pieces and overlapping parts of the text. Why? Because this way it will be always a relationship in between every chunk, no? With the previous and with the posteriors. And you will understand very soon why. So I made the splitter. This is giving me 78 different chunks of this book. So we have in total 78 files of 10,000. Well, here, don't be mistaken, we are not counting tokens, we are counting characters. And then on, we create embeddings for every each 78 documents. We put it in vectors. It's a list of vectors. You will see that every vector has 768 dimensions, and the vector of zero, well, yeah, simply gives you a prime. Is a list of numbers of flows. We don't care about that. It's just a representation of the text. And then what I'm doing here now? Well, my approach here is just simply take I had n chunks, and then I'm going to do a clusterization and choose an arbitrary number of clusters, and for this cluster choose the most representative document for that cluster. And then in this case I'm creating 21 clusters. You can choose less or more. Obviously you cannot get above the maximum, or sea, the number of the documents you have. In this case I use 21, we have 78 documents. So this means I'm going to create 21 groups of related documents. It's going to create 21 clusters with the 78 documents we have. So this we do it with K-means. K-means is a very well-known document for clustering, and well, it's very simple to do this. Why is very simple? Because we already had the documents transformed in vectors of 768 dimensions. No. We look at the labels, and the size obviously is 78 because we don't have one. I print out here in a plot just to make a graphical representation of our document. It is quite dispersed. And what I'm doing right now, I'm just choosing the most representative document of each cluster. That is why, well, you can play around with a little bit with the number of clusters. But here what I'm doing is, okay, this cluster had, I don't know, 2, 3, 4, 5, 20 documents. I just take the most representative chunk. If you remember, the clustering is going to take all the vectors, the 78 vectors, and put it all together in a cluster. This means that all these documents are very, very similar, no? And then what I'm doing now is taking the document which is more close to the centroid of that cluster and choose it like the selected to later on be summarized, no? This way, what I'm doing here is just take the most representative document of each cluster and put it in a list. And then this way I have 21 different documents with these indexes, and then on I send all these indexes to a another LLM. So I'm creating here another prompt. In the prompt I just send a text, and then I make me a summary of this 21 selected chunks of the document. Okay? Pretty simple, right? And then for here I'm just creating a logic to make the summary, return the summary of this chunk. Remember that this is 21 chunks of the full document, and then make a summary and put the summary in this list. This is gonna take a while, probably 20-25 minutes. When it's finished, I will be back and we continue with the process. Hi again, this has finished. We produce finally a summary of the 21 chunks that in which that we choose to summarize the book. Just you have here an example. This is the first one, the number of the summaries that we produce, obviously 21 because we have 21 clusters. Then on I join the summaries into a single document. The document had the this is document is a class as well from LangChain. You create just a single document with all the summaries. It had 1520 tokens. We create another LLM, another pipeline. You want to say that saying you can remove this as well, it's not necessary. Tag summarization, model tokenizer, blah blah blah. We create a combined prompt, another instruction to the LLM. We call the function. expansion Lost Sumeric Chimes, and we just create the summary. And that's it. Just play around with this stuff. I just take a document, it's arbitrary. I just want to show you how it works. It's the plan is use this massively with the different documents. I hope that this is gonna work. I hope that you enjoy with what I show you. And if you like what I do with my channel, just give me a like and subscribe if you didn't do it before. Thank you very much. Bye.